All right, so let us talk about the derivation of torque equal to I alpha. Okay, we'll take a simpler case, okay, and then we'll try to extend it to a generic case. Suppose, stop talking. This is the axis of rotation, it spins. Okay? It is a fixed axis of rotation. I am going to prove torque equal to I alpha for the fixed axis. Okay? Suppose angular acceleration is alpha. Alright? If angular acceleration is alpha, this perpendicular distance of the point mass m1 is, let's say, is r1. For, let's say, m2, the perpendicular distance is r2. Okay? So the acceleration of m1 is what? Alpha into r1. Acceleration of m2 is
alpha.
Alpha r2. Okay? So, acceleration are in opposite directions. Are you getting it? That is understood. Acceleration is in opposite direction. We will talk about it later on. But right now, the net force on M1, let's say that is F1, will it be equal to M alpha R1? Is this the net force? Mass M acceleration? M1. Is this the correct thing? There's something wrong here. Tell me what it is.
So you're neglecting all the force. Wait, no.
I am taking acceleration as alpha r1. Is that the only acceleration? There will be centripetal acceleration also? It is moving in a circle. Right? So, centripetal acceleration will be omega square into r1. So, there will be centripetal force as well to provide centripetal acceleration. Centripetal force will be, this is what? Tangential force. There will be centripetal force, Fc, which is m1 omega square r1. Yes or no? Two forces are there, tangential and centripetal. But the good thing is that centripetal force passes through the axis. It touches the axis. So the torque because of this force will be zero. So torque will be only because of this tangential force. Is it clear? Okay. नोटबुक खोला नहीं कहां लिख रहा है दिमाग में लिख रहा है बकवास मत कर सो टॉर्क बिकॉज़ ऑफ द फोर्स f1 इज व्हाट टॉर्क बिकॉज़ ऑफ ओनली दिस फोर्स व्हिच इज हाउ मच
m alpha r1
परपेंडिकुलर डिस्टेंस इज r1 सो टॉर्क इज व्हाट
m alpha r1
This is M1 alpha R1 into R1. So this is what? M1 R1 square alpha.
And then you sum that for the R1.
Yes or no?
Yeah.
Torque on this M2, although the acceleration is in opposite direction, the torque will be in the same direction. Because both are same sense of rotation. So if you add up all the torques, you get a total torque. Are you getting it? This is the total torque, which will be equal to summation of mi ri square into alpha. Okay. This will be equal to summation of mi I square is what? Moment of inertia about that axis. So I into alpha. And what is the summation of all the torques? This will be equal to sum of all external plus the internal torques. Now, summation of all internal torques will be zero. Why?
So because equal and opposite force.
Sum of all forces will be zero. Ye to bhai Newton third law hai. Newton ne bola. Summation of all torque, you have extended it from your side. When net force is zero, is it necessary that net torque will be zero? No. So why net torque is zero? Why net internal torque will be zero?
So because it will, one will, like let's say there's a force between two particles, one will generate a torque in one direction, the other will generate it in the opposite direction.
Prove it mathematically. Kar mathematics to kar. Prove that sum of all internal torque will be zero. Just take two masses, okay? Here are two mass. Internal force hai, right? Internal forces will be acting towards each other, equal and opposite. If one is F, other will be minus F. You need to prove that torque about this point will be zero. Take that as origin. This is R1, that is R2. Prove it. Sum of all torque will be zero. Forces two at a time, they'll cancel away. So that is why net internal torque will be zero. So from there it comes out that net external torque to a rigid body will be equal to I into alpha about the fixed axis. Okay.
So why is it zero?
What is zero?
Torque.
You are not there in vectors. You have not seen the videos. Do you know how to subtract the vectors?
Explain it again.
R2 is this, R1 is this. Where is R2 minus R1? Tell me. You won't see the video. Or while having your dinner or lunch, you can watch the video. Copy pen, you should have it. Make the notes. Treat as if it is in a class. Okay? R2 minus R1 will be this vector or not? The triangle law. R2 plus this vector x should be equal to R1. R2 plus x is R1. This is the x will be equal to R1 minus R2. This way. But anyways, whatever way it is, either it will make 0 angle or 180 degree. Both ways, the cross product will be 0 with F. Fine? So sum of all internal torques will be 0. So net external torque will do I alpha about the fixed axis. Alright? And there is a proof of the center mass axis also, but then it will become very involved. This formula, torque is equal to ICM into alpha. This is also true, but torque you have to take here about the center mass axis. Alright? I'll just give you a basic logic, or let's say overall logic of it. If you are using any other axis other than center of mass axis, okay, other than center of mass axis, if you use and there is no fixed axis, okay, then there will be a pseudo force. There will be a pseudo force which is going to act about the center of mass. See, this derivation assumes that this axis is fixed, right? So what you will do, you will stand on this axis and look at the entire rotation. Fine. When you look at the entire rotation, if it is fixed, no problem. But if this axis has an acceleration, you will have to apply the pseudo force. And that pseudo force point of application is center of mass. So then you have to use torque due to the pseudo force as well over here. But if your axis passes through the center of mass, then torque because of that pseudo force will be 0. Okay? And other than that, there is a proper derivation of all that. Okay, but if we keep on doing that, 15-20 minutes will be gone and we'll lose all the track of it. It is not going to be used anywhere. Okay, just remember these two equations. You can use one about fixed axis, other about the center mass axis. So if there is a fixed axis, it is easiest to use. Center mass axis is safest to use because center mass axis always valid. Fixed axis you may or may not find. Okay? Any doubts? No doubt? No doubt? Aise kaise? I have 5 minutes for doubt.
So, for the derivation of that, the torque internally is 0. We said that like the two masses, one with force F and minus F, they like cancel each other out, right? But what if like we have more mass on this side of the axis than this, so we have like more particles here than here? Won't that affect the internal torque?
See, more particles here and there doesn't matter actually, because this point doesn't assume that both the particles will be. Both the particles can be on the right hand side of this point. It doesn't matter.
So, but if you have like 10 things with force minus F and 5 with force F.
Cannot happen. Cannot. All the internal forces should add up to 0. Does you agree?
Yeah.
So how can it be happen?
Okay.
If somebody is applying F, on that minus F will be applied. That is a Newton third law itself. There will always be a pair. Okay? Any other doubt? No other doubt.
So when you're using this ICOM, I have center of mass. So you said that you have to apply something extra, some pseudo force or something.
If you're using about center of mass, then you don't need to worry about torque into pseudo force. No need to worry.
For the first fixed axis, actually.
Fixed axis, anyway, you don't need to worry about anything. Because you are standing on the fixed axis and looking at everything. But when you are using about center of mass, you are standing on center of mass axis. Even though center of mass accelerates, the torque due to the pseudo force will be 0. So that pseudo force torque will not come in the equation if you are using torque about center of mass is equal to ICM alpha. But if you are using about some other axis which is neither fixed nor passing through center of mass, then you can't use this formula. So basically this formula you can use only about fixed axis and about center of mass. Okay, let's not debate on it too much. Just take it like a thumb rule. Okay, assume it to be like the rule which you should follow. Okay, it will keep your life simpler. Many of the students don't even know, by the time they come in class 12, they're about to pass out also, nobody tells them that you can use torque into alpha only about 2 axis. Okay? A teacher from Fiji came, I interviewed, he also did now.
How?
How kya? Matlab, jaruri hai sabko sab cheeze pata ho.
That's like forgetting. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you grow old doesn't mean that you know everything. Okay. Even if like from, I also don't know everything. Like, if you give me a question, probably I may not be able to solve then and there. Okay. Because the mechanics is vast and it is not about how much questions you complete. It is about then and there if you are able to think. Still, I have a couple of questions from some JEE Advanced batch. There is a question which still, for it has been a month now, we are not able to solve it. And it is from kinematics. It sounds so simple.
What is it, sir?
I will give you, please attempt it at home. I keep on thinking about that, like while teaching you also I might be thinking about this problem. Okay. So this is a icy river, frictionless.
Like it's frozen.
Icy river, icy matlab, it's frozen. Glacier
rahega yahan pe. Wait, is it frozen?
Yeah.
Frozen. Icy river kya hota
hai? Like a river with ice in it.
Oh. Achha, nahin, frozen. This is frictionless. No friction. Mu is equal to zero. Okay. Here, coefficient of friction is mu on the surface. Okay. Alright. Here is param standing. Alright. He has to cross the river at the shortest time possible.
So you Snell's law.
What?
You yeah. Snell's law.
But answer nikal, kaise bhande matte. Theek hai. You have to find out the shortest time it will take to go to the other side. Are you getting it? Now it he can't start from here. Reason? Frictionless, na? He will not be able to accelerate, he will stand there only. He can't just run. Are you getting it? So he has to start from slightly behind. And the moment he is slightly behind, he is taking time to reach the... So you, there is some optimum distance. But if you assume that you go in a straight path, you will get the wrong answer. There should be a reason, logic. And answer, final answer I'll tell you,
Sir, I've seen this question before, sir. Have you seen that video where 3-2-1 Rao? He's done this.
Because it won't go straight.
It will be like this. Snell's law. Yeah, Snell's law. Why won't it be straight?
Snell's law.
Kuch bhi logic mat do. Please copy down the answer. It's not that straightforward. I think it came in some physics Olympiad somewhere. Do you write down? If you think it is simple, two step, you are wrong.
So why won't it be in a straight line?
Even I am wondering right now.
So because
if you chup ja, 2 minutes. If you assume it to be a straight line, the answer come out to be 2√L/μg. Which is actually more than this. So walking in a straight line is not even possible. So, I mean, that is little strange. So I started to do some research. Then I found out that when a runner is running, he is not putting his, I mean, it's not a wheel that is rolling. So he is putting his feet like this. So there will be some angle at which he will push the ground. Right? So maybe that is the reason why the acceleration will not be equal to mu g all the time. maybe you have to go a little bit in detail, but just little bit.
Wait, sir, but he's moving at constant velocity.
Constant velocity kahan se aa gaya? Constant velocity is not possible. Constant velocity only in the icy river.
Yes.
Here he is moving because of friction.
So how much can he accelerate with?
Huh?
Like we need how fast he can accelerate, right?
Acceleration is friction force mu mg divided by mass, mu g is the acceleration. That is straightforward, but that itself is wrong actually.
No.
Only external force on the person is friction. What else external force is horizontal direction?
No, but if he himself is running.
Wait, so but then
what do you mean by he himself?
Then how can I walk at different speeds? If the friction,
what?
So how can I walk at different speeds if friction is always the same?
Friction is acceleration, speed is velocity. Kya bol raha hai tu?
No, how can I accelerate in different accelerations?
You can accelerate, but you don't need to. If static friction can vary from zero to maximum friction. You are not skidding while running, right?
Leave it.
I should not have brought this up.
Oh, you're gonna solve it.
Okay. Alright, we have 20 minutes. We'll continue solving problems. No point talking about a new concept. Or should we talk?
Let's just talk.
Alright, so let's. Right now.
What
mind? You have that person right in your class.
Ranavar Singh.
Devosko.
He left.
No,
why?
He's in 12th. So.
Arnav is in.
He went to Kota.
Continue.
Let's continue this. If you get the answer, let me know. Lego. Energy consideration. अरे वही वर्क पाइन है जी वर्क में अच्छी तरह में हम जो अप्लाई इन द रिजिड बॉडी हाँ यू आर कंसीडरिंग एनर्जी वेदर टू अप्लाई और नॉट ऑन द रिजिड बॉडी अच्छा गलत है क्या तू लिख रहा है वर्क एनर्जी On rigid body, ठीक है? अभी सही है? Sober. ठीक है? इसमें कोई doubt? So we are going to apply work energy theorem, which is what W is equal to. You remember? U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. This I have to apply. On the rigid body. Okay? So, we know work done is what? Force into displacement of the point of application of the force. Okay? And I need to understand how to write the potential energy and kinetic energy. Alright? So, let's take one by one how to write the gravitational potential energy for the rigid body. Gravitational potential energy. Likho. Suppose this is the rigid body. Okay. This is M1 at a distance of H1. m2 at a distance of h2. Like that, there are different point masses. So total potential g will be what? m1 h1 plus m2 h2 plus m3 h3 and so on. I have to add up all the point masses potential energy on the rigid body. Logical, right? So potential energy total, orange charge. M1 g h1, assuming g is constant, assuming g is constant, okay, m1 g h1, m2 g h2, and so on. So it will come out to be equal to summation of mi hi into g. This is the total potential energy. Getting it? Okay. Now assume your y-axis in vertical direction. Let's say this is y-axis. Fine. So your hi is what? Yi, y coordinate. Okay. So this is summation of mi yi into g. Potential energy of a particular point mass can be negative. Suppose rigid body is still here. So the y coordinate will be negative, so automatically consider the potential, negative potential energy also. This is my reference line, zero potential energy, which we all always draw horizontal line, right? Wherever we write the potential energy, we draw horizontal line for the gravitation. Now, I know that summation of mi yi divided by summation of mi, this is what? Y center of mass, or let's call it as h center of mass, height of center of mass. Got it? It could be negative also. Center of mass could be here. Okay? So this will give me summation of mi yi is summation of mass into ycm. This comes out to be, please stop talking, mgh center of mass. This is how you write potential energy. This equation is still valid for rigid body, but I don't know how to write the potential energy and how to write kinetic energy for rigid body. Just now I have learned how to write the potential energy. So now I can write u2 and u1. Alright, got it? Now let us try to find out how to write the kinetic energy. Okay, kinetic energy of a rigid body. Why we are doing it separately? Because rigid body can rotate, and when it rotates, every point will have different speeds and velocities. Okay, so I need to add up all the masses, velocity, half m1 v1 square plus half m2 v2 square. Like that, I have to add up all the kinetic energies of all the point masses, right? The way we have done for the gravitational potential energy. Okay. Write down kinetic energy. This is third class of this chapter. Then I need one more class. So we spent 1 month on rigid body dynamics, system of particles. Kinetic energy of a rigid body.
Or like somewhere here.
We'll take different cases. Case number one is, let's say, fixed axis. Please write down. Fixed axis. So I'll first find out the kinetic energy for the fixed axis, how to write. Let's say this is the rigid body, and this rigid body is rotating about this fixed axis. Angular velocity omega, there are masses, R1, M1, like this. Okay? So kinetic energy, total kinetic energy is half m1 v1 square plus half m2 v2 square and so on. Got it? V1 is what?
Omega
R1. Omega R1. Why I am writing in terms of omega? Because omega is fixed for entire rigid body, right? So I can write it as half omega 1. Please write it as my daughter has started remembering my mobile phone number. She is like whenever she wants in this call. WhatsApp bhi aa gaya, start sending stickers and all the. So V1 is what? Omega into R1. This is what you'll get. Okay. So this is half m1 r1 square plus m2 r2 square and so on into omega square. What is this bracket term?
I
about fixed about the fixed axis. This will be equal to half moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega square. So if there is a fixed axis, you don't have to do anything. Just write half I about fixed axis into omega square. Okay. This is the case one. What if it is not even rotating? Everything is just moving with velocity v.
Half
mv square, simple. It is as good as a point mass. So that we are not considering at all. Any doubts? No. Now case two. The axis is translating. Okay, rotation plus translation. This is the rigid body. Let's say it rotates with angular velocity omega and the center of mass is going with VCM. Okay? Any doubt? This is generic case. Yes or no? Alright? So velocity of a point which is here, which is at a distance of R1, will be what? VCM plus omega R1. This will be the velocity. Yes or no? Okay. And I am assuming my y-axis to be this. This is, let's say, x-axis and z-axis comes out, let us say. Center of mass is my origin. Okay. This is V1 and it will not be as simple as this. It will be a vector sum actually. R cross omega plus VCM vector. But we are doing it in a simpler way. Are you getting it? So kinetic energy will be equal to what? Half m V1 square. So half m into VCM plus omega R1 whole square. This is the kinetic energy of the mass 1. So like that there will be different masses. So total kinetic energy will be what? summation of half mi vcm plus omega ri square. You need to prove that this is equal to half icm omega square plus half m vcm square. Prove it. Times of VCM into omega into RI.
Oh, no, sir, but this is the vector sum, so that's not what it is.
What?
So this is vector sum of VCM and omega R1.
So what?
So it's until VCM square plus omega R1 square. And then
no, they are not perpendicular to each other. VCM and omega R1 are not perpendicular to each other.
Okay, sir, but plus, yeah, sure. But it's still the vector sum, right?
Correct, so there will be a cos theta factor coming in. Understood that. So there will be multiplied by cos theta. So like I said initially, I am taking it in a simpler way. Okay? Otherwise, there will be a cos factor coming in over here. Okay? So this will be equal to half of summation of mi into vcm square plus summation of mi ri square into omega square plus this is what you will get. See, like we have discussed, r is not a distance. It, you have to consider it with sign. It's like a position vector. Fine. So r can be negative or positive also. So what is this summation of mi ri?
Zero.
This will be zero because summation of mi ri divided by summation of mi is your center of masses location, which is zero. So this term becomes zero. This is what total mass into vcm square. This is icm into omega square. Okay. So this is what the proof is. Half m into vcm square plus half this. You can take it exactly like a vector, but now enough, I have to do something about you and I'll do it soon. You can't smile like a fool when I'm telling you something. As soon as I turn my back, you start talking. You talk to him, then talk to him, then kaise kaise baat karna hai tereko. So you can treat it like a vector also. So this, if you want to take it like a vector, V1 will be equal to VCM plus R1 cross omega. Like this. Okay? Fine? So, you can use this. Try doing it like this. Take V1 like this. Anybody try it like this? What will be V1 square then? When you square it, how much it will become? V1 square will be what? VCM square mod of VCM square plus what? Mod of R1 cross omega square, then plus 2 VCM dot with R1 cross omega. Getting it? Dot, from the dot cos theta factor will come out. Fine? So when you add up all of this, it will be dot with M1 R1 that will come outside. M1 R1, M2 R2 and all that will come out, come inside the bracket, dot with VCM. VCM is a constant vector. The summation can go inside VCM. So VCM dot of M1 R1 plus M2 R2 like that. So it doesn't matter whether it is, we have taken simpler thing so that you understand the philosophy of how it comes. You can do it with the vector also. Okay? Okay, any other doubt? Any other doubt? Tell me one thing. If the axis is translating only, it is not rotating, then omega into R1 or R1 cross omega will be perpendicular to axis or parallel to axis? Sorry, R1 cross omega will be always perpendicular to the perpendicular axis or not? It will be perpendicular to axis, isn't it? So over here, this term,
if you take translation into consideration, won't there be any omega?
So there won't be any omega.
Yeah.
Which omega is?
I mean, say only translation.
Not only translation, I'm saying translation plus rotation, both. See, this R1 cross omega, you need to understand. See, guys, R1 cross omega square, what it is? Here we have assumed that RI is a perpendicular distance from the axis. When you do R1 cross omega, it will be R1 sine theta into omega. R1 sine theta is actually the perpendicular distance. And in moment of inertia, summation of MIRI square, it is perpendicular distance square. Are you getting it? So your R1, so when you do it, this summation will come out to be MIRI square sine square theta I. Ri sine theta I is your perpendicular distance from the axis. Getting it? So see, that is the reason why I don't want to get into too much of detail. Otherwise, I start seeing the blank faces. This is what it is. This is for the ith particle perpendicular distance from the axis. And that is square into mass summation will be your moment of inertia, not Ri square. Getting it? Any doubts? No doubts. Okay, so that's it for today. We'll continue. Next week we'll finish up this chapter. And is optics a part of your last year it was?
Again changed it. I think we don't have optics.
Huh? CBSC. So optics is not there. So after this, what should we do? What is going on in school?
Gravitation.
So in one class, what can I do in the other class?
Gravitation? You are doing gravitation after work energy, right?
Yeah.
It's
okay. Do you have two teachers in school?
Different classes.
Different classes, same teacher.
Two different teachers.
One teacher per class, right?
Yeah.
Chemistry. Chemistry is not.